We're the Super Smash Opera. For you.
I know one.
You thought this was a Q&A where you asked us questions, but it's us asking you questions.
We're Super Smash Opera fans.
Yeah.
We appreciate everybody for getting up early.
Yes.
Watch us clear our costumes.
I'll go on.
Every time I see someone with the headband on, I keep thinking you're in Kung Fury. I'm like, why aren't you doing your job? But you're not. You're just.
I'm just a zombie.
Yeah. It's fine.
You could have been a cop.
I could have been a contender.
Trust. Yeah.
Could have been somebody. So, yeah,
we
who are you?
We should introduce ourselves, because people might not know exactly who we are.
Yeah. We are the collective known as Super Smash Opera.
Hi, I'm Ben Wallace. I was the conductor today.
Hey, I'm Marge Rischel. I was one of the authors. I did the non-costume puppets and most of the graphics for our show.
Hi, I'm Jim Newsom, and I play Master Hand.
Where's the? Here it is. Hi, I'm Bonnie Bogovich. I played Link, Puccini Puff, aka Jiggly Puff, and Ice Climber number 2. From the original version last year, I was the music director and arranger and one of the lyric writers.
She ran the website.
And I run the website. And the Twitter feed.
Yes,
thing. And I'm the person who knows how to internet.
You do all the things.
Yeah, it's good. I'm Sean Lenhart. I directed it. I helped write it. I'm in it. I smell nice. I played Luigi, who stabs a lot of people, and then I played Ganondorf, who gets stabbed by a lot of people. And I was a terrifying looking Pikachu. I don't know what meme that is, but that's totally a meme somewhere. Oh yeah, and did all the fight choreography with the wonderful people.
I'm Jesse Buddington. I played Star Fox, Mario, and I operated this Pichu puppet. I also wrote all the choral parts for the choral and orchestra version of Smash Rock.
Hi, I'm Liz Herschel. I was the costume designer. I was one of the founders, lyricists, etc., and I played Zelda slash Sheik, Ice Climber Pink, I played a Pikachu, and I did,
Hey everyone, I'm Sebastian Wolf. I orchestrated a large percentage of the orchestra pieces, the parts, a lot of help from Bonnie and Jesse, and I helped being rehearsal accompanist. It's good to have you. Hi, thanks for going.
We also have my wife, Mary Lou, dressed as Samus today, and Matt hiding somewhere, so he was also helping on backstage doing great work. That's Doug. Doug is cool. That's Kenny. Kenny's gonna ask obscene sexual questions.
Not right now.
So if anyone wants to preempt the insane sexual questions, please start asking right now. I'll just start picking on people. In the Sonic hat.
Hi.
Hi.
I've never seen you before.
What you doing?
What am I doing? I don't know. I just saw some seats. I figured I'd sit down.
Awesome. There's Matt.
Matt just walked in. Here's one of our stage managers.
Everyone make him feel uncomfortable. Look out.
I just was going to the bathroom. Come on.
So I should probably start this by introducing myself.
Yeah.
By mentioning that Matt was one of the creative sparks where this project came from. About 2 years ago, he and Bonnie and I and Jim were at MAGFest, And we've gone to see several panels, and we had a wonderful time watching the Proto Men and all this wonderful stuff. And they weren't here 2 years ago. They were here for three years ago. But anyway, he said, you guys should do an opera in the style of video games. They have largely the same plots. A lot of operas are about guy saves girl from other guy that wants to marry girl, and that's very Mario. He said, why don't you take the Barber of Seville and just change kind of the characters into Mario and Luigi and Peach and Bowser. Those are like basically the main characters anyway. And we were like, oh, that's an interesting idea. But the more we thought about it, the more that we realized that that exact thing wouldn't quite work because we wouldn't have the right voice types going to MAGFest. And we were like, well, there's only really one song from that show that everybody knows really well. And then the rest of the show, they would be kind of bored. So we said, let's do an original show and take all the famous pieces and just sort of rewrite all of the lyrics and make them our own thing. And that way we had a lot of control over the voice types we would have, the characters, you know, out of the people that we knew were going. That same year, Bonnie mentioned that idea to Jesse Buddington from San Francisco, even though most of us are from Pittsburgh. Jesse is from San Francisco and Sebastian's living in Seattle. Although he was living in San Francisco at the time. And they thought it was really cool. Jesse wanted to be involved. He's, you know, our tenor. So we decided to write parts for them. And it's really an amazing thing of the internet age today because Jesse was able to learn his part via Skype while Marjorie stood in as a body double for him on stage and wore his costume and did all of those things. And last year was the year that we debuted Super Smash Opera as, you know, an accepted panel, but not as guests, necessarily. And Jesse's flight was delayed, so he only arrived about an hour and a half before the show started.
Actually arrived halfway through the rehearsal right before the show went on.
We didn't even have time. He never even had the chance to run the show once last year. He just got to run his particular songs, and then we're like, all right, in you go! And we were up there.
You were really hoping that the costume fit.
Yeah, it was like, yeah, we were basically, luckily he was Mario and he had that giant bat suit, so we were pretty sure that.
And luckily
it
was a smashing success.
Yeah, it worked out really well. Just
no, that was just a large costume.
You guys saw a Smash Opera last year.
What?
Ooh, how many people in the audience saw a Smash Opera last year? Thank you so much for coming back.
Yeah.
Awesome. It's better with a live orchestra, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. There were a few things that we weren't quite anticipating when we did the recorded track, and that is, we didn't really know how to plan for applause. Because there were lots of times when people would start clapping, but the music is relentless. It just keeps going. It's, you know, a pre-recorded track, and we're just like, I can't hear the beat anymore. Just sing! You know, we did our best.
We also didn't have any monitors at that concert, so it was actually very difficult for us to hear the pre-recorded part. You know, when you have a conductor, you can look over and see the stick going, and it's really easy to follow that.
Yeah, so it's funny. We stayed much more on.
It's pretty
funny because, like, MAGFest posted the YouTube recording last year of our show, and in their video, you can hear everything pretty well, but I don't remember hearing most of the music. And I'm like, I hope this is it.
You mentioned specifically Jesse's Arwing pilot animal.
Yeah.
And it just goes, he's like.
Arwing pilot animal was really tough because it has a section built in where he has to stop and think for a few seconds and then hop right back in. And the only way we could do that without an orchestra was to have.
Yeah.
Oh god.
Going in the background, and he had to count those beats while he was talking out.
Yeah, which it's way nicer to be in my character being like, instead of having to be like,
meanwhile,
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, you know.
Yeah, and back then, like all of the practice tracks, Jesse would record himself singing against something that I would send. It was like a boomerang thing, because we basically had me arranging to temp stuff that you would send me, and you just going, and I'm like, that's the longest. So now that's going to be your break forever. Let's count that out. Because there are 17 beats. Right. I'm going to give you a drum for practice only.
And back in the day, it was hard because his voice actually came in before the music.
Yeah.
He had to start singing before the music started.
We all had to
not
much
beat.
It was
just ruined.
Yeah.
But it made it fun. And I also like that, like, Jesse, you're sitting here now, and it's funny that we finally get to see you with legs, because you're usually on an iPad, type, like, gaffer taped onto a mic stand.
Is this better?
Yeah, that looks more like a So, I've only physically seen Jesse with legs, like, 3 times.
We've seen Jesse's head, we've seen his Mean Girls poster.
Oh, yeah.
It's a calendar.
And he has a stuffed dragon in his office.
Yes, this is like a fat chair.
We know his, like, where his... His video sure. chat setup is.
There's a piano sometimes.
Yeah.
There's like a girl who walks by.
So, I'm fairly goth. I pretty much dress like this all the time. I have only black furniture, I have only black clothes. My friends decided for my birthday this year that it would be really funny to get me an entirely pink Mean Girls calendar. And it's really wonderful. I've been like re-enjoying,
It looks nice.
All the Wednesdays are pink!
Yeah, all the Wednesdays are pink because, you know, if I were to wear a color on Wednesdays, I'm supposed to wear pink.
Yeah, internet.
But yeah, they've basically looked into my bedroom, and I've looked into their living room countless times. I feel like I almost know your...
If you ever come to my house, you know where everything is. Yeah. Sometimes we pick you up, like, I'm going for a walk, Jesse. We're going to the kitchen. And we're back. You've seen my upstairs.
Yeah. Yeah, I've seen most of your house at this point. Yeah. Like, I don't have a choice on where I go. They just kind of pick me up and take me up. I'm like, okay. So this is happening.
Here we go. Hold on. We used to take him to this cat scratching post before I thought about the music stand. And it'd be funny because we'd be rehearsing and then suddenly, like, Jesse's like doing this around.
Oh, yeah, the cats would start scratching my thing, so my screen was open.
Oh, the joys of working remotely.
It would get, like, off synced and then your voice would get super high pitched and fast.
Oh, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
Keep it back. We're like, Jesse, we can't understand. Just sing it. And I'm like, no, we're just dying because you're already a high voice person anyway. Yeah. So you would go up like 3 octaves and sound like some weird digital.
I just expected that was actually just him doing that.
Just a mess with you. No. I wish I could sing like that. Then I could do, you know, her job.
Jesse, I have never mentioned this to you before, but I was always impressed with your commitment for doing this long distance. But the rest of us here in Pittsburgh, if we like ditch too many rehearsals or something, and, you know, somebody could knock on their door and say, "Why aren't you at Elk practice? I mean, it's not rehearsal." But you know, you had nobody local who could like rouse you out of bed or whatever.
You're 3 hours ahead.
That's true.
Yeah, the time difference is
working. But like, you gotta realize that like being able to rehearse for a video game themed opera is like every classical music nerd's dream. I actually get to do, you know, early Baroque recitative and sing about, you know, being the heroes of Nintendo and things. That's really, really wonderful.
Of course, working with someone from San Francisco also meant that we're like, okay, rehearsals start at 9 p.m.
Yeah.
Because it was like 3 hours behind.
Well, yeah, I got off work at 6, and so you guys would have to start at 9
p.m. Yeah, we have to start basically when he's available. So anyway, I'm curious, how many people in the audience sing or are fans of opera in general, aside from Smash Opera?
Sweet.
See, that's very encouraging, because we want our show to be, like, enjoyable by everyone. We throw in a lot of opera jokes, as well as a lot of video game jokes. Particularly our choice of Link, being played by a woman. If you ever see a lot of opera, you see a lot of men who are played by women in what's called pants roles. And that's because in early opera, there was a very unethical practice that resulted in men having a very high voice.
Tell me about it.
We don't tell the children this in education school. But yeah, so lots of Mozart operas and things like that, but there were very high-voiced men, and now those parts are played by countertenors or women, and hence our joke about Link being, quote, a pants role, where a woman is playing a high-voiced male role, and we make a joke about that where Zelda obviously tells Link that he was very much like a boy.
And the excuse me, princess line was just like, we had to...
We couldn't try.
I mean, we also have to work in as many video game jokes as possible.
I mean,
that was the subject of much discussion, I remember, that we knew we wanted Link to say, excuse me, princess, at some point, but we didn't want to bust it out too early,
yeah.
So we were deciding when to play each card.
I just liked making you practice it over and
oh,
over
God.
Again. Because I'm like, it's not quite annoying enough.
And watch these YouTube videos.
And I was just hilarious because I kept saying, what am I doing wrong? What, how am I saying wrong? And they were so critical. And I haven't seen the video clip since, what, college? Because it's been out forever.
You kept starting too high. You're like excuse me.
Like, excuse me. No. Excuse me. And they're like, there it is. I'm like, I can't talk like this all the time. It's bad for my voice. Because
I feel so bad for you. I've been talking a weird voice all the time.
At least you get to say English for most of your stuff.
I think at one point we notated it. And we're like,
excuse me.
The excuse me, Princess Q.
And Princess.
Can we talk about notating the Pikachu song real quick?
I love writing for voice. And once we, short backstory. The reason that Queen of the Night and Papageno are in our show is because Mozart, Magic Flute, has a couple of popular songs that people mostly recognize if they've seen the movie Amadeus. Actually, it has three pieces. Well, no. Amadeus also has the commendatory, which Master Hand does, which is the, you know, that's But Magic Flute, Liz, actually, the MAGFest that all this brainstorming started, she didn't go out to the jam session tonight because she had to save her voice to audition for Queen of the Night, which she got. But then she got cast and she's like, so we're doing this thing. I'm writing like Zelda's Queen of the Night, right? And we're like, yeah, of course. And then I'm thinking, oh, Papageno's really fun. If only there was a multi-syllable critter that sounded kind of like Papageno, that would be easy to, So Papageno, which is known as pa, 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 I'm like, we have plans for you. But then the fun was, okay, you'd think that turning Papageno duet into a trio would be easy. But then you realize that you have two Pikachus and one Pichu, and they all can't say the syllables all at the same time sometimes. So poor Sean, Jesse, and Liz had the joy of reading my extensive sheet music
normally a duet, and we turned it into a trio.
Yeah. So Pikachu, two Pikachus and one Pichu ended up to many rehearsals to get the chus and the p's and the ka's and the everything lined up appropriately, and I think we just nailed it by the final, the actual performance.
Really terrible if we said a chu in the wrong place.
If you said
a ka or
the, we got people that got chopped up, Pichu chu.
It's all written out. We had to.
I had a very strict. So you guys with excuse me, princess, I gave you the Pikachu dream.
That's what could happen. We try to rehearse, we're like, oh no, let's go back to the PPPP. Which one? The entire song! Okay, so the 50, what, just start from the beginning. It was very confusing. Oh yeah, right there, yeah. And I sang Pika Pika Pika. Oh no, you sang the Pika Pika Pika. Oh, okay.
Yeah, you're putting the wrong emphasis on.
A Pikachu. Oh. How do you moonwalk Pikachu?
It's one of the
Pikachu.
Anyway.
The German version.
That was.
And that was really fun because I come running right off stage from my chic transformation and Sean's holding up Pikachu's ass and I'm like,
hey, you guys don't get to see all the stuff that goes on behind the curtain.
Like, there's not much of an emotional, like come down off of that.
It's like the butt from episode 7. It's just,
These Pikachus were a challenge, though, that I was originally going to make all of them like this one, but everyone insisted, well, the puppets are going to be singing, they have to have moving mouths. And last year's Pikachu. Smaller and all. These are like foam and face, and to get the mouth movements right, they're actually more like a fursuit head than a traditional hand.
She made them a little bigger because we knew that we would have like a bigger house and more people in the back, and I wanted to make sure that everyone could see them.
Yeah. About a week before getting all the puppets packed up and bringing them out, they were about half finished, and one of these Pikachus had one side of its mouth completely hanging open. And so Sean would puppet it around, and it'd just be like...
It was like half a Pikachu, half a predator. It was awesome.
Yeah. Sorry. My phone of the puppet. puppets in each stage of development, and there's a few that are kind of scaring me.
How about the last puppet that was made right before the show? The felt, everything had to be hand sewn. The fleece was strong enough that I could put it through a machine. So like Jigglypuff, who was mostly glued, was done like I think in time for the final dress rehearsal. Until the final dress rehearsal, I never had a Jigglypuff, so I would just wander around and be like, I guess it's gonna be something like this. And Marge came up with this ingenious design. If you've ever seen, like, at the zoo, they have these things on a stick, and there's a little claw, and there's an alligator head, like, that's what this is. Except the claw is like this little thing in here, and the whole, and this is like a styrofoam ball, right, cut in half, and it's just like, it's not like that.
She literally bought one of those and put it inside.
So if you rip this open one day, like, if there's ever, like, an autopsy or biopsy, I forget how it goes, there's a little alligator in there. Just suffering.
The secret of Jigglypuff is actually filled with alligators.
How did you put it?
That is strangely believable.
Yeah, right?
An actual question.
So whose genius idea was it to set the body disposal scenes to kazoo?
the kazoo
that was
players.
That was actually improvised during the dress rehearsal. We have Sebastian and Kristen actually are affiliated with Project Estati, who have a bunch of kazoos they've been handing out. I think Kristen's got just a huge bag of kazoos. And we ended up providing them to all of our choir members, and they decided they were going to just sing that song during the body disposal.
And it was beautiful.
Just a surprise to me. I'm like, I'm directing this, and this is happening. I'm like, that's weird.
The two things that ended up being spontaneously thrown into the show kind of day of were that kazoo piece, and then when Zelda reveals herself, the little vibraphone.
Oh, yeah.
I used to just sing that.
Yeah. He literally just played it during that scene, and she was like, keep that.
That was today. Guys, do we have any, we haven't really let the orchestra guys talk yet. We have two new members to our crew this year, which is Sebastian Wolf and Ben. Do you guys have anything, insights that you'd want to share about your experience of being dragged into, or offering to be in this the day after the show last year?
It's incredibly rewarding to work with, something like 22, 23 total musicians and choir members who just completely elevated the entire experience. You know, last year we had MIDI backing tracks, which was awesome. You know, slightly embellished MIDI backing tracks. But just having like all the luxuries of a live performance hit. With people and stuff.
And a conductor in case things flew off the rails that could
also, yes,
and like bring us back in.
Yeah. It's just so rewarding.
I have no idea how stressful that was. I was going to say, what's it like working with, 22, 23 people who you've never heard before and have no idea how well they play?
It's interesting. It was really surprising, and it was really awesome. We were rehearsing in this room last night.
Oh, yesterday afternoon.
Yesterday afternoon.
And the other one, a couple hours before this.
Yeah. And we were just like, oh, this sounds like a thing. Like, this sounds like what it should sound. Which was good, because we had no idea, who we were going to get, when everybody signed up for it. But then, having the full orchestra there this morning, super early, 8 o'clock in the morning, was like really, really awesome to just kind of go through the show. And I was very confident because this is how a lot of other orchestra projects are run, specifically things like BGL, the Zelda show, and all these big video game orchestras. You get everybody shows up, you do one rehearsal, everybody goes off and gets dinner and maybe drinks, and then come back, and then they all do the show. So I wasn't super worried about it, but coming in and working with everybody remotely, because I live in Connecticut, so I was also on all these Skype rehearsals with everybody watching Sebastian and Jesse and Bonnie, the whole
body double march.
Yeah, and body double march. Actually, I thought you were going to be on stage. That was a surprise to me, and I was like, oh wait, because it made the Star Fox thing make more sense to me with the resident thing, because you were miming it and then you spoke the words, and that is if you turned something off. And it made more sense to me then. Like, oh, Jesse's just, which was great, but it made more sense. But, yeah. Anyway, sorry, I'm rambling.
And you've also seen my living room.
And I've also seen your living room, and I've seen the whole living room shake when you moved me from the couch to the floor, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, no, but it was a lot of fun. It was really rewarding to work with all these guys and participate and wave my hands around. So
I should say also that in addition to body doubling, Marge was our story director, and she had the arduous task of fitting all the songs in along with and writing scenes so that people would have a chance to change into their other characters.
Yeah.
Some of us had some pretty complicated changes.
This show.
Yeah.
What's your quickest change, guys, would you say?
Oh.
Because I can definitely say that my quickest change is I go straight from Ice Climber into Zelda being thrown across the stage by Ganondorf, with only the scene where Master Hand and Fox are arguing over the dead Ice Climber.
That's fast. My fastest is after you insult my masculinity and I run off stage as Link crying. I then quickly have to strip everything off and grab my Jigglypuff and run back up the stairs.
My fastest is probably the second time that I'm Ganondorf right before I die. I probably have the same amount of time, but by that point I'm so exhausted because I just murdered Mario. I'm sweating, I'm just like, get this off me. There's a cape. Oh, I got a headband, I got a belt, so I'm just exhausted. And then I go out and fight some more, and then I take a nap. With the cape over my head, so the air just heats up and heats up. You're gonna die. And then I get off and I have like 20 minutes to get my next costume. It takes forever. I'm just this fast at that point. But I think you probably have the hardest one, actually.
Yeah, mine I wouldn't be able to do without our stage minions. But I have to come off as Mario right after I've, you know, basically been a dick to Luigi. And there's that very short scene with Luigi and Zelda where she's talking about Mario not being a villain and him being like, are you kidding me? She's like, well, you know, maybe somebody trained in the secret arts, and then Jigglypuff pops out, and the whole scene takes like maybe a minute, and I'm like frantically getting out of this jumpsuit, and I have my Star Fox costume on under the jumpsuit, which, by the way, it's incredibly hot, and then I have to put the helmet on and walk on stage and be a completely different character, but that's a lot of fun.
There was a question?
Yeah.
Oh, I was wondering, had the orchestra had the parts for the music ahead of time, or were people doing sight reading mostly?
That's a good question. So it turns out that orchestrating 22 pieces is actually sort of a lot of time that goes into it. Our original plan actually was having all of the parts out by the beginning of the year, you know, having had Christmas break, where people go on holiday and don't arrange music instead. So what ended up happening was everything was a little pushed. So I think we had parts done. Most of the parts were about 2 weeks out,
yeah.
Which makes it all the more impressive to have like such a fantastic performance of people who had parts for no more than maybe a couple of days, where they had time to practice and, you know, sort of a lot of lessons were learned.
The most important part is the next time we do this show, we're gonna have everybody's part written.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it turns out that, like, luckily for the orchestra, a lot of opera is, if not super predictable, at least kind of regular, until you get to Wagner. And then Wagner is like,
oh god. Oh god.
I think I'm playing the right notes.
It doesn't matter, everyone else is playing a different note.
Right.
It's definitely a change from Mozart to Wagner.
I see a question.
During like rehearsals and whatnot, did you have any particularly entertaining flubs with the costume changes?
Jim's finger fell off once.
Oh.
This whole thing has like a weird skeleton under it, so it was real creepy.
Think Terminator with a cute Mickey Mouse glove.
Yeah.
Last year the glove was kind of put together in pieces.
Yes, this is the softer, friendlier hand 2.0. First version was basically a Terminator hand with a very sheer piece of fabric over it. And, you know, kind of a
Velcro?
Basically like a sock over each finger. Occasionally it would fly off.
Yeah.
Then there would be a creepy Terminator hand.
It was very villainous.
Like I'm wondering, like, do we really need to put a glove over? Because that's just—it's monstrous looking.
That's crazy.
It's like a wall master from Zelda. That's what it looks like.
That's
the
Smash Brothers headcanon from now on. Master Hand is actually a Terminator underneath.
Well, like supposedly it's literally the hand of the guy who makes the games. That's why like it changes from game to game. So we put the little line saying like it's the avatar to the window into the world. That's like the smallest way we can hint that the hand is a person. But Terminators are people too, so yeah.
We could always want to do one of those Deus Ex Machina endings and just have like the, you know, the robotic hand come down.
The hand puppeting the hand.
Yeah.
we had a flub the other day. We were just doing the fight call. And we always go nice and slow, and then we work it up to speed, work it up to speed. I'm a stickler for that because the same little mistakes come, like make sure you're bending your knees, make sure you don't lift your ankles, make sure you're not, you know, bending over too far. And part of the fight is tricky because I want to purposely make mistakes for Ganondorf to have him lose, so I do some things that are kind of rough. And we have the hardest time whenever Liz throws the chain ball at me. Somehow in performance, I catch it. But whenever we're practicing, I just smack it out of the air like I'm playing tetherball. So we practice that over and over, and then she has to kind of chain walk towards me, and she hits me with her left elbow. Well, this one day, we're going through it, we get up to speed, and something goes wrong, and she goes with the right elbow. And I'm like, okay, I'm going this way now. And then, because I went the other way, she comes in to punch me in the stomach, and actually hits me in the stomach, and so I jump up, I'm like, ow, that kind of hurt, and then wraps the chain, not around my shoulders, but around my neck. At which point, Liz says, like, she woke up and went, oh no, I'm gonna kill her. So she just kind of held still, and I just spun around, and I'm like, can you try that again?
I'll ask another going with the fighting thing, because I forgot this happened yesterday. I lost a pair of shoes.
Oh yeah.
Yesterday during the orchestra rehearsal, and I thought it was okay because we actually it probably started earlier when we were in panels one doing just basic stuff. Because I was like, whoops, I guess. Oh, I'm okay. I slipped a little bit, and then we're running the Hyatt to Ho, which is the Wagner, one of those lovely Wagners. And I was going along, and I thought I tripped on like a cable, and my foot just went out, and suddenly the whole bottom of my boot broke off. Like the whole, literally, like you can see my socks through it. And yeah, so the good news is I didn't twist my ankle before the show. The bad news is there goes my snow boots for the year. So I'm currently wearing my costume boots for the rest of the weekend because luckily they were my only pairs of shoes.
CVS socks.
And I had to buy CVS socks. They're comfy.
I had one during the actual show, during the time where Luigi is stabbing me a whole bunch. You definitely punched me in the back.
I apologize after. I'm like, oh, no. No, Liz on many occasions has straight up punched me in the back. I'm like, Liz, can you just...
No, this one, like,
and then, not today, I didn't mention it, but the last time during the last dress rehearsal, when you pulled it back, you pulled the snaps and you jammed the armor into my throat. I was just like, oh, and then I had to die, and I'm lying there like, please be able to talk. Please be able to talk. And I get up and I'm like, hello.
Oh, good. Thank God. There are so many wonderful ways to get injured during this show.
I thought Luigi had frustration.
Yeah. No, like, they're great. That's the thing, is that anytime something's like unsafe, we can stop and be like, wait. And since we're always rehearsing in Bonnie's living room, there's like the TV and there's windows. So we're always like, it's going to be really easy on stage because we have space.
Yeah, my living room's not huge, yeah.
And also, it was just really nice of the DC Stunt Coalition people. They left their mats on the stage till like Saturday, so it's wonderful that we get to use them when we're doing this hardcore choreography and jumping around and killing people and stuff. So it makes my knees feel great.
As far as costume faux pas, last year when we were doing the panel, so the Zelda dress that I pull apart for the Sheik transformation is held together with magnets. And they're kind of like purse closures. That's actually what they are. I bought them in the fabric store. So there's like two on one side and one on my hip. And last year during the panel, when Sean threw me onto the stage, all of them gave up.
Oh.
And I was like, basically for the whole scene. And I'm like, I'm standing here. My clothes are coming off. Like, people are probably like, what the hell is me?
It's
fine. You just have to be really huffy.
But yeah, it turned out to be like basically that whole goal was only holding together. This year we changed the belt a bit so that it wasn't like drapey. It was like more around my upper waist, and that made it a little easier. Nothing snapped this time when it wasn't supposed to. But yeah, that happened a couple of times. And I was like, oh dear God, please don't have to go. There it goes.
One more funny thing that happened with the puppets was during rehearsal, we... So, do we have them?
Yeah,
okay, so
guys.
These little creatures that were on the poles, right? Well, they were originally maybe like not quite as secure, so we were like, for the first time that we ever, you know, did, they were like fighting and stuff, and their limbs just started falling
Leg.
It's like that bit from the Addams Family where they're just like chopping limbs off of each other.
Actually, only one of them lost its feet. What goes on with these guys? Last year we had a sign with little Pichus on them that we put in the background, and it was just a cardboard sign that had like Pichus that look happy and have little smileys, and then when they were angry, we flipped the sign around and they all had angry faces on the other side to show that the battle was starting. But the drawings didn't look compatible with the actual plush puppets. And like, just for, you know, as an experiment, I had made like a bunch of like little jointed Undertale characters last fall. And I was saying, hey, I've got these marionette characters. I think that I could adapt that to our Pokemon. And what I screwed up was these guys are all wire joints here, and then one under the ruff of the neck. But I had just cut a hole in the cloth and threaded the joints through it. I didn't put in any stitches to secure it, so the more they moved around, the wider that little hole got. And finally, one of them just flew both his legs off.
We had a lot of fun before the puppets were finished because we just had like Pikachu heads, and we didn't have the Pikachu puppets yet, so we were just running through practicing the movement again. I'm like, all right, so just grab whatever's nearby. All these prop knives, cool. So we're just dancing around, singing with a knife and a severed head. Just la, 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 la. And I stopped looking in the mirror, and I'm like, guys, no, I can't do this. Because every year the pizza guy shows up in the middle of the song. Every year we order food because we're exhausted and hungry, and he shows up, and we're in the middle of a song, we're all dressed up in someone's house, all the furniture shoved to the side, we're like, hey, pepperoni! I swear it's the same guy, too.
And of course, dance ends with where the Pichus are here, and then the Pikachu comes over them. So basically, it's like we're stopping a Pikachu head onto a knife.
It's very Cannibal Holocaust. It's always that particular pizza guy. He has like two days left until he retires.
Yeah, he showed up once when we were in like full costumes. Like, just imagine going to somebody's house and needlessly seeing like grown up people for a party, but just like five or six of them, just all like dressed as Mario Brothers.
Cool. And also, we finally expanded this past fall beyond the pizza guy because we were like, oh, the weather's nice. Let's take our fight choreography outside. How weird could it be?
Oh, no.
My neighbors, I don't think even know what the hell we do in the house to begin with, but there's like an elderly couple next door and their relatives were over and we're in my backyard stabbing each other and running around and sword fighting, and I'm doing my Link, of course, because I have to do the you know, and they're just, and all I look over and one is sitting on their little swing, they have one of those swings, and they're just like this. And then there's two people inside the kitchen in their window just like looking at me. And I went inside, I'm like, do we tell them what's going on or do we just let them wonder? What's better?
The whole time I'm yelling things like, you know, no, no, lead with your hips. No, really dig into that. Thrust harder. No. When you spin around, make sure you're not aiming for my face, you're aiming for my shoulder. And they're just like,
So there's actually two flubs that you guys got to experience today. You may not have noticed them.
Oh.
So when both, you know, when Sean's character dies and when Jesse dies, you know, they pretend like they're dead. But when we drag off Jesse's body, I think we accidentally stepped on your head.
Yeah,
So you guys got to see that, him trying to pretend like he's dead while we're stepping on him. And then poor Sean.
today, I pick up his sword and I set it down on him. But in a certain sensitive area.
Oh.
If you look at the doll.
So go.
John, where on the Pikachu did Matt hurt you?
I see the way
you said we were going home, then we went to the woods. Then we went to the tall grass and looked for the electro pill come on.
I think I got really dark.
He's dead still.
I'm looking for deep and insightful emotional questions. Hopefully from the guy dressed as the brawny paper towel dispenser guy. Yeah, that's you. Yeah.
Okay. How many of you got into opera for the first time by watching Looney Tunes?
We're not into it from Looney Tunes?
No.
And you play the great scene. Little opera pieces just creep up in life.
There was actually one moment I remember having where Looney Tunes actually screwed me up, because there's a moment in Rabbit of Seville where it does like because it plays a little wedding thing because he's fake marrying Elmer Fudd. And I didn't realize that that's not in that opera. That's actually from a Wagner opera.
I will say that at least for me and a lot of people like in my family, I didn't know we got into opera other than Bugs Bunny because we were obsessed with Pirates of Penzance for some reason, because the Kevin Kline movie with Angela Lansbury came out like in the late 80s, early 90s, and it was really awesome. And I did not know for a long time until I was, in school that Gilbert and Sullivan was opera. I was like, it's a musical. That's not opera. Opera's boring. Unless it's Bugs Bunny. Then it's okay. But then I was like, oh, Gilbert and Sullivan, and like Liz and me and Sean have been in the same Gilbert and Stan gym, have been in the Gilbert and Sullivan troupe back at home, and it's a blast. But you tell people that Pirates is really opera, and they kind of go, what? But we have a lot of Pirates in our show.
It's I'm directing Pirates of Penzance with the group now, and it's just fun because all the media for it. I'm like, oh yeah, and then all these Savoyard alums were all doing this project, and all doing this project and stuff. So it's nice because all the Pittsburgh ones, we all come from like the same theater circle, and so every show we do, it's like, oh, it's with these people who overlap with these people and whatnot. And
we actually had a thread going on a Facebook page for our Gilbert and Sullivan group where we were posting YouTube videos of Warner Brother cartoons. Where Gilbert Sullivan comes up, like Animaniacs has this one where Yakko is singing, I am the very model of a cartoon individual. Yes. And then Freakazoid has a whole ton of them, from the Lord Bravery theme song to the Freakazoid song.
And Simpsons has
Simpsons, of course, with Sideshow Bob singing his score to HMS Pinafore, which we love, the camp of Cape Fear.
Yeah, I'd say for me, it's mostly Animaniacs that got me to be like, oh, opera's pretty fun. Fox Wings is great, but Animaniacs is totally good.
So given that you guys have written a bunch of the lyrics for it, and that you're actually doing some of the original shows, what likely is it that you might accidentally say substitute lyrics?
Oh my god. Last year, Sean and I were both in the Mikado right after Super Smash Opera, where the Ice Climbers are singing Three Little Maids from school, and I was playing Yum Yum, and Jim was in that show too, and I was like, Jim, I'm gonna sing If Two Little Maids Think One Away in the show. I know I'm gonna do it, and I didn't, but I was like, if I do that, you have to jump on stage and go, why not out of here?
And then the other two maids are just going to be really confused.
But we're hijacking the
thing. Yeah. I did Pirate King before and I'm doing it now, so it's... Those are hard lyrics to begin with because I already have them set in my mind, so whenever I've changed them to Gerudo King lyrics, I'm always like, can I look at the words on the screen and just, no, I'm not going to actually do the job. But right now, especially, because I have that so soaked in my head, and I'm working, it's double cast, I have two new Pirate Kings to teach and like impart upon. So doing the show, I'm actually amazed with myself when I get the words right. Because in rehearsal, I'm constantly just like, oh, wait, another cheating world! Crap. Something, where a lot of playing, I don't know. That guy plays the vibraphone.
Yay! Hey, Doug!
I'm not a part of this panel. Please
go on.
Might as well.
Any questions?
I was curious, I know you guys have mentioned roles that you've played before and some arias that you're already familiar with. Were there any other arias that you've already done in other performances that you haven't mentioned, or were there any arias you've always wanted to do and like worked in the show so you'd have the chance to sing it?
You mean this show that we did?
Yeah.
I have always kind of wanted to do Brunhilde, because when people, I was playing opera, they're like, the lady with the horns? But I also always wanted to do a pants roll, so the excuse to do Hayato as Hayato was really fun. It may not sound as classical because I'm doing it in a freaky voice, but I've always kind of wanted to do the opera stereotype thing. So I feel happy that. And I'm a sucker for, I just love Madame Butterfly, like Umbeldi is so pretty. And the thought that one, as soon as we decided to have a Jigglypuff, I was like, can we just call it Puccini Puff? Because it'd be cool, the syllables work, and we can just make it sing Puccini. And I was like, the first 8 bars of Umbeldi is the only thing people ever remember anyway. So that's all she says, is the first 8 bars, ever. And it's easier for me, because that's my favorite part, and none. So that's 2 that I got to knock out. Each one is under 20 seconds long, but they're fun.
Nice.
But Liz had one too.
Oh, I was gonna say that poor Jim always got the shaft when it came to arias. Not necessarily, but we're like, I'm gonna sing a coloratura aria. I'm a coloratura. Bonnie's gonna sing like kind of a lyric aria. She's a lyric. Okay, Jim, you're gonna sing the song from Carmen. You're gonna sing the song that doesn't actually have lyrics to it at the end of the show when you're chasing Jigglypuff around. We're just gonna make some
difference.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I was really psyched to do Commendatory. I was definitely happy to have an excuse to do that. And Habanero is a lot of fun. What else would a bass get a chance to do?
Yeah. Yeah.
You're gonna do a woman's opera. You're registered.
I ran into kind of the opposite problem because we're choosing the most famous arias from opera, and so as a tenor, I have to sing La Donna e Mobile. And I'm about 6 inches too short and about 300 pounds too light to sing that aria. And I sang it for them, and they're like, wow, that was great. Now you have to do it while slowly sinking to the floor while being stabbed in the back.
It's also really funny because when Marjorie wrote the lyrics to that one, and Jesse's like, that's fine, as long as you don't put me on the high note on an E vowel. And we're like, you're saying Luigi.
Yeah, that only leaves me Luigi. It's like all of the E vowels.
You have nothing but E vowels.
There's this much blue.
I guess for me, like, if I'm going to strictly answer the question, it would probably be something from Pinafore I'd want to add. Because I really don't understand why the beginning of HMS Pinafore, or rather, a British tar isn't like the national anthem somewhere. I don't know why you don't sing the British tar and then play a soccer game. I don't understand. But, like, for me personally, music-wise, I'm a musical theater guy. Like, opera's fun, but I love musical theater, so everything I want to sing is, like, a crazy, rich, super baritone claw version of Part of Your World. Like the Just Around the River Bend or something. I want to take like a Disney Princess song and just, yeah, the whole thing.
You know, public domain.
Public domain is.
I saw a question over here.
I came a little bit late, so we already answered this, I apologize. But I was curious, when this was written, did you already have in mind who was going to play what roles, or were you not sure?
Mostly. We had kind of a round table discussion about that, and we talked about like, oh well, these are the songs that we kind of really, really enjoy, and who could sing this, what could this theme be, and we kind of talked through it, you know.
It was more that we had certain voices, and then we picked characters that those voices could act and sing in. You know, we each have certain characters that we could do. There were certain ones that we needed to do. We had to have Mario, we had to have Luigi, because they had to have that sibling rivalry that results in death. That's
and some things we added just for nice comedic balance, and because Liz being a costumer and Marge being really amazing with puppets, it's like, well, we need to add some levity, so the ice climbers are only in one number other than the introduction, but it's adorable, and it's our only chance to show that Master Hand tries to have like a lighter side, and he murders them senselessly and kills them off. But And Pikachus really didn't have to exist, except it gave something for Jigglypuff to almost fight, and it was a great excuse to do a Popocatépetl trio.
We love puppets.
And we love puppets, and we just want to have more puppet opportunities, because we know people love puppets. And it's fun to sing.
It also greatly expands the cast, where you can throw, you know, a puppet on yourself, or put one on your arm, and be a completely different third or fourth character.
Yeah, basically, like, I think that what it came down to was which arias lent themselves the best to which characters, and which voice types were suited to that the most. Because then we're like, oh, this would be a great, you know, Queen of the Night aria would be a great aria for Zelda transforming into Sheik, because it not only is thematic to the show, but it's thematic to the original source material for the aria itself. You know, it's kind of true to everything. And then, like, the whole, oh, what if Link were to sing Hayatoho, what in Link speak? You know, that would be great. And, oh, Gerudo King, that's like Pirate King, and that would be perfect. And, you know, Sean looks like Ganon. Or, that's great. He's just, he's feeling green. Yeah, so we had like a big round table. Oh, so we have which characters should we have? Which characters don't we have time for? How many costume changes can we have? How long do we want the show to be? And what's the most famous that people will get and come along to?
There was a question towards the middle aisle.
Oh, well, she kind of asked the question I was going to ask, which is, how did you decide what characters to do and what songs to pick?
You,
and also,
you guys should fight to the death.
That's
how it works.
So I guess I will ask my backup question, which is, you said earlier that you were here seeing the Proto Men three or four years ago, so what are your favorite Proto Men songs?
I love you.
That was technically my question.
But I didn't want to ask. Like, send personal message, like, dear Proto-Man. We are going to take an entire, like, column of seats and leave it empty. And that's where Kilroy will sit. And then, you know, the rest of you over here, and Commander over here, and we can put you in the orchestra if you want.
I'm a real fan of Max, too.
Yeah, probably Breaking Out for me, personally. Like, it's hard not to say just one, but probably just Breaking Out.
Yeah. The Hounds.
Yeah.
Because I like watching Wiley dance whenever they do it live.
Throw out the water bottle. Yeah.
The city made us.
Yeah. Do they have Rock Band 3 or Rock Band 4 in the arcade?
They have one of the Rock Bands. I don't know which one.
If it's 4, then they have Light of the Night, so that's what I'll be doing for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
I miss them.
So good.
They're not here.
I like the Will of One.
Will
of One is
great.
Yeah. What's yours?
If I had to pick one, which would be very difficult, probably The Stand, which is interesting.
This one has good taste.
Because they never perform it live, but they ended up performing it live when they were here last year, which I really, really was happy about.
Yeah. So. I've actually seen that twice. They did it once in Pittsburgh because, like, the year before, it was a really, like, weird venue and it was really weird concert. So, like, as an apology, they were like, hey, today's going really, really well. Here's The Stand.
Yeah, what they did with ours was stuff kept, like, screwing up. Like, I think during Father of Death, the audio was, like, screwing up. So basically, like, Panther had to, like, shred on the acoustic guitar. So basically, later on in the show, he was like, well, since everything's screwing up tonight, let's just play a song that we haven't played in a while. And they started up The Stand.
Problem was, that was the night they didn't play Breaking Out. I was...
Yeah. Oh. I do remember that. They skipped right into Keep Quiet.
Good backup question.
Anything else?
I'll ask another question, actually.
Okay.
I'll be selfish. Okay, so yesterday I went to the Ella McLean panel, and Ella McLean talked a lot about opera and brought up Mozart, brought up Queen of the Night. So I was wondering if in the future would you guys collaborate with her or talk to her, possibly?
If she wants, if she wanted to work. That's not so much dependent on us, it's dependent on her.
She's kind of famous.
We would be happy to work with her if she wants to play a part.
If she wanted to be Link, I would be. I don't know if she wanted to run around
to GLaDOS master hand or something.
Yeah.
I would be very happy if I found out she came to our panel.
What was the most challenging song that you've done?
In this show,
yeah.
Death of Puff, which is basically gluing the entire sequence of Master Hand versus Jigglypuff is four different pieces of music glued together with awkward transitions and key changes. So that's a fun pain for, especially for the orchestrator team, trying to figure out how to translate my brain into real instruments instead of synthesizers. And turns out you can't play every key in violin easily, and 7 million sharps is
yes,
not.
Yes, you can.
That should be a post. Just with an instrument as name. But it is hard to do that. Plus, like going in and out between Wagner and Puccini and Mozart. Yeah, it's a bit hard. So I'd say that was the most challenging, you know, for Jim and me to coordinate. Plus, I have a deaf slow motion fly off before I die. That's the hardest.
Not on saxophone.
Not on saxophone.
Saxophone is hard.
Well,
yeah.
Not
that much harder. Another question is on the registration. So it was an unusual band that you put together. It's very impressive. But I'm wondering, like, what was the process behind that? Because, like, it's just, like, how do you decide, like, which to orchestrate for? Do you have to make, like, changes based on the personnel? How did you work that?
That's a good question. That's well, so we originally sent out a survey last year, you know, trying to gauge interest about what performers would be interested in the instruments they have, what they could bring. We got a ton of feedback.
Yeah, because I was saying like,
close to 80 responses where people expressed interest in the joint, which would have been incredible. Of course, you know, as things happen, schedules change things. Our
people not sure if they're coming back.
Exactly. Our three oboe parts of our sample had to be reduced to one oboe part.
Yes!
So a lot of those last minute changes found out a little bit too late, so that will crunch it.
I can also say, I think eventually, I mean, this was mostly a Hungarian. Up on this until I sort of joined in on the orchestration party. But since the orchestra was so large and haphazardly mild, yeah, it's like most operas from the birth of opera, Monteverdi, all the way up to those were like Strauss, you have a pretty standard orchestration of just winds, which is like flutes, oboes, clarinets, bassoons, horns, trumpets, trombones, maybe tuba, and then strings. And then before then, you get way less brass, way less winds, and then just harpsichord or continue or something like that. But since we had saxophone players sign up in melodica and automaton and stuff like that, I think basically I made the mistake of not doing this in the few orchestrations that I made, so some people just didn't have parts for some of the numbers. I think we sort of retooled everything for first an orchestra in winds and twos, which means just two of every woodwind instrument and then standard brass and string arrangements, plus saxophone, tenor saxophone, melodica, or people were playing melodica who just did a little flute part system, you know, that everybody was really, like, accommodating for playing something else. Our trombone player, we made a mistake of not putting a lot of trombone in, because a lot of these operas don't have any trombone. Most stuff from before Wagner has very little brass music in it whatsoever, so our trombone player just picked, like, was a super trooper and just played all the tuba parts and just bounced notes up and down. And it worked, it was fun. Like, everybody was really, like, flexible.
We're actually really impressed with the caliber of performer that we got. We got so many people that were able to be like, well, you know, this part isn't necessarily the right part for me to be doing, but I can play this cello part on my, you know, horn. And like, it really filled out the sound. It was fantastic that we had so many people that could read so many different kinds of notation.
Now, but does this mean that if you're doing the show again, you have to completely reorchestrate pretty much everything based on whatever you have available?
So, well, the biggest thing was putting it all into a digital format, so right now it is accessible, so shuffling parts around wouldn't necessarily be that complicated. It feels like the bulk of the work really has been done, so retooling it for new orchestration wouldn't necessarily be too complex.
Unless we add new songs.
Unless we add new songs.
And new characters.
Yeah, and also I would say the solution to that is just, I mean, we would, for some of the numbers, there's a part for literally everything. I think it would just require going through each number and creating a part for literally every instrument for each one. And then it becomes a super variable, oh, we can do it with this ensemble, we can do it with this ensemble. We just have a library that will be able to do literally anything.
Exactly.
Almost like everyone.
Originally, the way I approached the orchestration was giving the orchestra a lot of doubling, some of which would have been unusual in other circumstances, but we really wanted to, you know, bring a big sound
get the most out of the score that we had, even if certain ensemble pieces were doubling up on some of the awkward parts.
So we're almost out of time, I think, but I want to take a second to make sure everyone can pimp whatever little projects they're doing and stop before we go.
Okay, this is a shameless self-plug.
Shameless self-promotion.
Shameless self-promotion, yeah. I am in a video game band called Disco Cactus.
Woo!
The band is here. We're playing tomorrow afternoon at 4 p.m. in the concert hall. Be there.
Yes.
Okay, let's see, shameless plug number two. In addition to doing puppets and graphics here, because I'm kind of artsy, I draw webcomics on a site called lepusstudios.com. That's Lepus like a rabbit, L-E-P-U-S. I have some character cards here, if anybody wants a free card.
Jameson.
Let's see, material projects.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, a lot of material, actually.
Listen to that.
Yeah. Nicely done. I've been part of the first two, hopefully not, so hopefully there will be many more Materia projects. So if you haven't heard Successor, which is the latest one that just came out, a bunch of people in this room are on it. Go to materiacollective.com and download both of them, because they're really awesome. Otherwise, that's my, I guess I'm putting it over.
I do voice acting and audiobook narrating from home, which is a lot of fun. And I have a podcast called A Couple of Geniuses. So if you want to hear more silliness from me and my friends and just talk about crazy video games and MAGFest and stuff, I have cards for that too. We're like on iTunes and we have a Patreon pretty soon, so it's going to be awesome.
I have a bunch of musical stuff going on in San Francisco. I'm not going to be on the opposite coast. I also work at Louder with Sebastian. So, if anybody out there is doing video game or other cover songs and wants licensing for them, I know how to do that. I'm actually doing a bit of a licensing panel as one of the mages things tomorrow afternoon.
Sean and I are involved in a new project. If you enjoy accessible opera, it's a steampunk ghost story opera called Steam or the Spectres of the Knox Mill. It's operatic singing set to rock accompaniment. It's going to be filmed and released on YouTube. If you want to find out more information about that, come to see me afterwards and I'll give you a card.
You're like this close to being on Kickstarter.
Yeah, we're about to launch our Kickstarter.
Like, yeah, we need a lot of
people. If you're interested in helping that happen, then we would really appreciate that.
I run an orchestration project alongside Kristen Igas and David Russell called Project Astati. We have pursuits for $1 at... what's the first one?
The merch room.
The place right in front of the concert hall sells the series for $1. Pick one up and support our
Rock Island.
Rock Island, thank you.
And I guess it's basically. Oh, a plug for the project. So we're at SuperSmashOpera.com, at SuperSmashOpera on Twitter, pretty much anywhere you can glue SuperSmashOpera together. And I think we also own SmashOpera.com as well. So just. If you like what you heard, follow us. That's kind of how we ended up coming up with the latest version for this year. Who knows what's coming up next? Though we have been talking about we're going to really try to release an actual album this year.
Oh.
Since we really would like to have a good studio album of the main songs in the show. We have a whole bunch of stuff up on SoundCloud as well. So if you like some of the tunes, they're all up for listening from our original demos. So thank you guys all for coming. And especially those who are here and playing for us today.
Thank you.